So what is operational modal analysis? Quite simply, OMA is a process for us to extract the modal parameters from a structure. And modal parameters are the natural frequencies of the structure, where it wants to resonate, the mode shapes or deformation patterns, vibration patterns associated with those natural frequencies, and then the damping for each of those modes. So those are what we typically refer to as the modal parameters. Modal analysis, operational modal analysis are similar in their purpose. We're trying to extract these modal parameters. We're trying to build a mathematical model of our structure to extract these modal parameters. And really, there are three main reasons. The first one being, if the real world usage of your product is going to differ from your laboratory-based measurements. So if we use our product or our structure in the real world, its modal behavior will actually change, and we'll take a look at some examples there. So testing it in the laboratory may not give us the information we're really looking for that the real world is going to subject our structure to. Then there's things like size limitations. If you're trying to extract the modal parameters of a bridge or a building, it's awfully hard or impossible to bring those structures into a laboratory, suspend them on airbags or bungee cords like we typically do, and do a laboratory test, you know, just because of how big they are. And then there are techniques like health monitoring or damage detection, where OMA or operational modal analysis might give us clues for, say, a distributed pipeline system, or even bridges or buildings where maybe we want to test the structure before and after something like an earthquake and understand whether the structure's been damaged. Even if there's no visual damage, a lot of times modal analysis can be used to detect that damage. So those are really the three examples of when you might be forced to use operational modal analysis. So if the real world differs from our laboratory environment, this is typical in something like car suspension, where there are nonlinearities in the structure. So if you test an automobile or something with a pneumatic damper suspension on it, it might behave differently when it's tested in the laboratory than it does when you're driving down the road. And this is true of the shock absorbers on an automobile. In the lab, when the vehicle is not moving, they are subject to a high amount of static friction, where that shock absorber sitting still, that static friction makes the structure seem much stiffer than it really is. And so when you drive your vehicle down the road, the vehicle is always kind of moving and the shock is always kind of being stroked a little bit, and there's no static friction, and you get a much more realistic amount of structural stiffness there. So something like that, testing that in the laboratory is very difficult to replicate that actual stiffness of the structure as well as the damping inherent in the shock absorber. And so a lot of times vehicles are tested in unique ways, operational modal analysis being one of them. So that's the first option. And then there are things like environmental influences, like airflow over our structure. We see the little animation of an aircraft. This is in a wind tunnel, where we've made a scale model of the aircraft, but just the air flowing over the structure induces this sort of vibration. This type of influence or interaction is almost impossible to model in a laboratory environment. You can build a scale model of the airplane and put it in a wind tunnel, but even something like the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, which is a very famous bridge collapse, that bridge ultimately was destroyed because resonant behavior was set up in the bridge solely by wind interacting with the structure. They did not anticipate the type of wind and environmental impact of that bridge in the Tacoma Narrows. And ultimately, it excited the bridge where it wanted to vibrate, and that resulted in a resonant condition, and the structure ultimately failed. So operationally, this type of interaction where you have air and structure interacting, almost impossible to do in a laboratory, so you really have to do it in an operational sense. So that's when the real world differs from your laboratory. Obviously, you have size limitations like we were talking about before. The animation you see here is of the Millennium Bridge, which is in London. And when this bridge first opened, I think it was June of the year 2000, you see the bridge wiggling, and that wiggling of the bridge or the movement is caused solely by people walking over the bridge. And so this was not anticipated. They ended up having to shut the bridge down, and they made some modifications to the structure, and they put some additional damping into it and things. But this structure, by people walking over it as designed, ultimately excited the structure in a way that they did not anticipate. And once the bridge starts to move, then the humans try to compensate and end up making the situation worse by sort of stepping in time with the oscillations. Very interesting case if you want to Google that. But it's a perfect example of a structure we can't move into our laboratory because it's too big. And even if we could move it into our lab, we would not be exciting it the same way that human beings walking over it would excite. So a little bit of background on operational modal analysis. Again, we're trying to extract these modal parameters from our structure, some things that make it unique, and we'll take a deeper dive into how it compares to the other techniques. But operational data, we're going to instrument our airplane, or we're going to instrument our bridge, and we're going to just take some data. As a function of the design of the experiment, we are only going to be able to measure a response, right? Typically in an experimental and modal analysis, we're measuring responses, typically accelerometers all over our structure. Then we usually measure our input, our force, either through an impact hammer or a modal shaker. We're measuring that force that we're putting into the structure. On an airplane, when you go fly it through the air, there's no way to measure the force that the air flowing over the structure is imparting to your structure. So we really only have time domain response measurements made by accelerometers. Okay, so that's the first big difference for operational modal analysis. We don't have any input measured, so we're going to have to do something differently when we try to build our math model. And so we're going to calculate frequency domain functions, these frequency spectra, using something called a correlation function. And we'll see how that compares to a regular experimental modal analysis. But ultimately, our end goal is to be able to extract the mode shapes, modal damping, and the natural frequencies from the structure. So if we look at just a high-level overview of experimental modal versus operational modal, the first box is the real key. Do we have a measured input in a regular experimental modal? Yes, we measure that from our input impact hammer or our modal shaker. Operational, we have no measured input. And so that's going to change our approach from the rest of the technique. Our measurement format in an experimental modal is a classic FRF, or frequency response function. We'll take a look at what that means. Those are not available because the FRF, by definition, relies on a measured input. We don't have that in operational. So we're going to use cross power and auto power spectrums. And we'll talk about how we get those, but the results ultimately are the same. Modal parameters, natural frequency, mode shape, and damping. One little note, you see the asterisk there on the operational modal. Because of the technique we're using to calculate these spectrums and the fact that we have no measured input, we will not be able to scale our mode shapes in the same mass normalized way that we do in experimental modal. Mode shapes are the mode shapes, but in order to normalize them, we really have to provide some input that we don't have. So it's not possible. So if we look at the first step, right, we're going to go take some data on our structure. In experimental modal, we're going to measure in the time domain. We measure our input force in red here. We measure a bunch of responses, a bunch of accelerations around our structure. In operational modal, we're going to do the same thing, but we don't have a measured input force, and so all we have is response accelerations. We're going to still call one of our measurement locations our reference. So in the experimental modal, our input, our force, is always our reference, right? In our FRF, it's always acceleration over force, that reference being that measured force. In operational, we just call one of our locations our reference, and then we measure a bunch of other responses. So it's all acceleration time data in operational modal analysis. Stepping back into the more classic experimental modal analysis, we'll take those measurements in the time domain. We'll typically window them to prevent leakage, just using a Hanning window. And then we will take those time domain functions and put them in the frequency domain by doing a Fourier transform. With our reference, we get an auto power, which we call S sub XX. And then we get cross powers, which are S sub XY. And then we calculate a bunch, a family of frequency domain functions known as FRFs, or frequency response functions. Those are defined as SXY, or the cross power divided by the auto power. By definition, we have that input force measured, and we come up with this frequency domain FRF. We use these FRFs, this family of FRFs, to do our curve fitting and our building our math model. Okay, that's typical modal analysis. Again, we don't have a measured input in operational modal analysis, so we have to make some assumptions about that. And if we look at this sort of block diagram at the very top, we have this input from our structure. Our structure is this H, this gray box is our structure generically. And we have some input X going into that structure, and we're going to measure some output of that structure, which is Y. And so in an experimental modal analysis, we can measure X, we can measure Y, we do that division, we create our FRF, our family of FRFs, and we define what H is. In operational modal analysis, we don't have that input measured, so we have to make some assumptions. And if we were to assume that our input is pure white noise meaning equal amount of energy across all frequencies in the narrow band. So we have this white noise assumption, equal energy at all frequencies. We multiply that by our system matrix, or our sort of our transfer function that our structure would impart to that, where its resonant frequencies are and things like that. If we multiply perfect white noise by that system matrix, the output matrix is identical to the structural matrix. One times any number is going to be that number. Same sort of thing happens here. So if we make this white noise assumption and our structure is valid for, or our operational condition is valid for this assumption, then all we need to measure from our structure in order to have its modal characteristics and parameters is the output matrix. Every once in a while, we will have excitation where this is not satisfied. If we have some sort of harmonic excitation, like a rotating machine, so an engine or a propeller or something that's putting out very repeatable harmonic excitation, something like that can show up in our output matrix, even though it is not coming from our structure. We'll have orders or forcing functions in our output matrix that are not due to the structure. And we have to kind of, it's one of the risks of this technique, but we are typically able to discard these in analysis in some of the processing, because they'll have extremely low damping and they'll sort of stick out in the data and they'll be sort of obvious. It's up to us to kind of know that this might be an option. We might have some harmonic excitation in our structure, so we have to keep an eye out for it. So the second step, we talked about building an FRF in experimental modal analysis. That technique relies on a measured input. And so for operational modal analysis, we do something different. We use something called a correlation function. We won't dig too deep into this, but it's interesting. It's a statistical technique for extracting repeating patterns in what appears to be random data. So if you just go take some acceleration data on any structure in operation, you drive your car down the road and you measure the acceleration on the structure, it's going to look like random data, right? You won't be able to see necessarily the frequency content that might be repeating the periodic aspect of the data, because it's going to have so much data there, it's going to be hard to see in the time domain. So a statistical technique we can use is a correlation function. And essentially, a correlation function is just comparing that function either with itself or with another function at various amounts of time delay. And so we just shift one of the functions in time and we compare it and see how similar is this delayed function with the original function. And we can get what's called a correlation function. So if you look at this example I have on the slide is just from the Wikipedia article on autocorrelation. But essentially, if we look at this data on the top in the blue, it looks like sort of random data. If we do an autocorrelation, so this function, this blue data compared to itself, just a delayed function of itself or version of itself, you see this harmonic content get extracted. This autocorrelation function is essentially a function between -1 and +1, 0 being there's no correlation, 1 is there is very, very strong correlation, they are identical, and then -1 is they are identical just 180 degrees out of phase. And so by delaying, and then the x-axis down here is the amount of time delay or the time lag. So as we go through, we see that the amount of correlation oscillates around a certain frequency. There's a periodic nature to this random data where every so often it has more correlation or then, you know, strong negative correlation with itself. And that is the underlying frequency data that's in that random looking blue data. So if we take this autocorrelation function, we now have something in the time domain that has frequency content to it. We can do an FFT on that time domain and get a frequency domain function. So this is kind of the underlying technology or technique that makes OMA different than EMA. And we'll see how that's done in the software. But essentially, it's extracting periodic content from a random signal. So if we go back to our sort of step-by-step flow chart or overview of the process, we compare experimental to operational modal. Again, we're measuring in the time domain. Over on the left-hand side, we just do the straight FFT and we get our FRFs. In the operational modal, we take these time histories that we measured and we do these correlation functions. Now remember, the purple function is denoting our reference location. So the reference location correlated with itself is going to be an autocorrelation. Then we take our reference and we do the correlation between the reference, purple, and all of these blue measurement locations, and we'll get a bunch of family of cross correlations. We can then do an FFT on those time domain correlation functions, and we'll get auto power and cross power spectra. Much like the family of FRFs we get from experimental modal, we get a family of frequency domain power spectra based on our measurement locations for OMA. And then the last step in both techniques is exactly the same. We take all of those spectrums, FRFs or power spectrum, and then we curve fit. And essentially we say, okay, let's build a math model, provide it poles and residues. And then with that math model, we can then extract the modal parameters, natural frequencies, mode shapes, and damping. So the main difference between EMA and OMA, how am I getting my frequency domain family of frequency domain functions? End result is the same, and the curve fitting is identical between the two.